You know how people say Google it to describe any online search? Where I'm from, we use Jeep to describe any 4x4 vehicle. The same goes for Zoom when describing video conferencing. This is exactly what happens with Docker. Think about it. You use Docker build, Docker tag, Docker create, Docker run. I've been doing the same for over 10 years now as a DevOps engineer and then as a cloud architect. But it's 2024 and there are different container runtimes now. Look at the most popular Kubernetes services, for example. They're not actually running Docker. The backend runtime is something else, like Containerd. These alternatives follow the OCI, which is the Open Container Initiative, which was created to standardize container specifications so you're not locked into one solution. But why am I even telling you this? Well, Docker, the company, wasn't making enough money. About 2 years ago, they decided to monetize their CLI usage. For instance, when you use Docker push or Docker pull without specifying a registry, the Docker CLI automatically uses Docker Hub, their managed registry. But Docker Hub isn't the only option. Suddenly, companies using Docker Hub for pushing and pulling images throughout the day started hitting rate limits. Their work ground to a halt unless they pay Docker for a token. Sure, you can solve this by switching registries, use AWS ECR, Google GCR, GitHub, Quay, and a bunch of others. But here's the real issue. Just like Docker Hub, you now have to pay to use Docker on your own machine. If you're on a Mac running Docker desktop, for example, and you're running Docker build or Docker run, Docker push, etc., for commercial purposes, you might be breaking the law. And if you don't want to end up floating in the middle of the ocean, locked in a shipping container, because that's what they do with container criminals, right? You might want to reconsider your next move. If your company isn't paying for Docker licenses, consider Podman. It's open source, it does everything Docker does, so basically a drop-in replacement with a simpler CLI that's free for both commercial and personal use. It's faster, it's safer, it's daemonless, and we'll get to all of that, and here's how it works. Podman, as the landing page suggests, is the best free and open source container tool system, and it is downloadable for any major platform. To make my life easier, I just went with Brew, but any method works. With Podman ready to go, we can start using its man pages for all options and necessary explanations, which are also available in its brief version through the help flag. Okay, let's get cracking. The first thing you want to do if you're not running on Linux is creating a Podman machine. Containers run natively on Linux platforms, and in my case, macOS requires an intermediary. When it's initiated, you can start it, and there we are. Podman Machine LS will provide the list of running machines. And as an initial hipster, I have to show off and detect columns to have a pretty table machine data that I can select the name from specifically. More on Nuchel and how it improved my workflow in the video above. I've mentioned that Podman is first and foremost a drop-in replacement for Docker, and it is. We can search for images with Podman search. Here's a list of available Redis images, which again, I'll pretty print with my shell to make them more readable. Podman comes with a very useful filter flag, allowing us to grab only official images, which is what you're looking for 9 out of 10 times, unless you're a fan of running rogue applications built in the wild by strangers. Let's run a container. Much like Docker, we provide a port mapping, an image, and all other flags that translate directly. You can basically alias Docker to Podman, and for the most part, you're not going to see the difference. So, Nginx is running, let's grab a browser and prove that there's no black magic here, and there we are, welcome to Nginx. Like Docker PS, Podman PS shows running containers. Like Docker, Podman uses -d to run detached containers in the background. Here's Nginx again, and here's the container listed by Podman with all the usuals as Docker outputs. An ID, image, command status, ports, and those random names, which if you're ever wondering how they make out these great names, it's not AI, it's just a long, long dictionary of names combined together into hilarious results. Before we dive in, let me tell you about today's sponsor, Twingate, the smart way to secure your remote access. You know how traditional VPNs are like having a single fortress gate? Once someone's in, they can wander anywhere. Well, Twingate flips this model on its head with zero trust security. Think of it as a modern city where every district requires its own access path. Much safer, right? But here's what's really cool, especially for you developers out there. Twingate now seamlessly integrates with Kubernetes, so instead of bouncing between engineering and IT teams, you can configure secure access right in your YAML files. It's all part of the regular engineering flow, no context switching needed. Setup takes minutes, not days, and works across all of your devices. Plus, you get enterprise-grade security without the enterprise-grade headaches. Whether you're managing a remote team or running complex Kubernetes deployments, Twingate handles the security heavy lifting and you can focus on what really matters, building great software. Ready to level up your remote access security? Head over to twingate.com for a free trial and see why thousands of teams trust Twingate with their secure access needs. So, our stoic Wu is ready to be killed. We can use the name or ID. Let's go with the ID and it's gone. Now, here's a trick for you container users. Both Docker and Podman support ps-q, resulting in a quiet list of IDs. So you can do it with any number of containers, but especially when you have one of them, you can run podman kill and then wrapped in a subshell command, grab the ID of the container you have using podman ps-q. If there's more than one, you can pick the last one using --last one. Moving on, like Docker, Podman has the top subcommand with running processes, which, if we tidy up a little, shows the current container, its running processes, and how much they're consuming. Now here's an important differentiator of Podman. While Docker needs its Docker socket to run, which is also running as root, Podman is daemonless and rootless. If you grab processes mentioning Podman, there are none, but Docker needs a bunch of them. Let's grab the user off of the ls output for Docker socket to prove the point. So these are critical but rather basic differences you're not going to mind daily. What is actually the best selling point for Podman is actually in its name. Pods. If you're thinking about Kubernetes, you're not alone. Podman, unlike Docker, lets you gather multiple containers in pods and have them run together. To access them through the CLI, Podman comes with Podman pod, which we can then run ps on to grab a list of running pods. Let's create one and name it web app. Sorry for the lack of creativity here. Now you may be surprised to see it's already running, even before we even told it to run anything. Every pod runs an internal infra container. An infra container is a lightweight container used to coordinate the shared kernel namespace of a pod, which is just fancy words saying it's an admin layer to help making sure everything is in order. Let's pour some stuff into the new pod. We can run -d for detached, point the command to, so name the container Redis and run, well, Redis. We've got too much information here to view the running containers, so let's grab the not so beautifully parsed number under the column named hash, showing us two of them. We can also run pod inspect to see the same JSON including both hash and state. Okay, let's test it. The nice thing about containers in a pod is that they don't have to have anything special to communicate with each other and can basically ping each other using localhost. Let's run a third container in the pod using --rm, we'll make sure it's deleted as soon as it's exited, and use Redis CLI with localhost as the target host to send a Redis command, and let's write the key named mykey, which will hold hello from Redis. We've got good result from the server, which is nice, so let's run another verification to read the key. Same idea, just get my key, and there's our string, hello from Redis, cool. So far, nothing fancy, but it works. If you want to run a container and connect to it within the pod, same as with Docker, we can exec into it connecting to a shell. Since Alpine doesn't come with bash, we'll just use the old SH, install Redis quickly, and send a Redis ping to localhost that comes back with pong. All working as expected. By the way, here's something cool by Redis. If we try to CURL localhost with Redis port and just to see what happens in a split, let's pop the Redis logs on screen, I get an empty reply from the server. But the logs below actually showing Redis has detected my attempt as a security attack. So it blocks non-standard Redis communication altogether. I didn't know that is even possible before. Right, so far so good, but if you're using or planning to use Kubernetes, the next feature is a real killer. Let's say that we want to create a separate new application with Nginx and Postgres as an example. We'll run Nginx and call it web, and then run Postgres and call it DB. Check this out, we can now run podman generate cube web DB, and I'll send it to a YAML file so we can easily review the output. Now look at that, a Kubernetes YAML ready to go using my two containers in a pod with volumes, mounts, and everything you need to throw it in a cluster. But before we'll do that, we have a YAML, right? What if we want to recreate it? Check this, podman, play kube, and a YAML lets you run the Kubernetes YAML files describing your pod locally. With our deployment running, podman PS reveals Nginx and Postgres just started, and running podman pod PS shows it as a running pod. Are you thinking what I'm thinking? There's no way this actually runs in a cluster, so let's do exactly that. First off, a small adjustment. Our deployment holds volumes and I'd have to create them in Kubernetes with this name, so let me elegantly shorten the name and send the volume mount to basically nowhere using empty-dir. If these kind of things interest you and you want to dive deeper, check this out. If all that Kubernetes talk is actually getting you curious and you'd like to jump in, I have a getting started self-paced digital workshop just for you. It'll get you from absolute novice to running your own cluster with a running web application, a database, and everything you need to get yourself familiar with the basics and create some working experience. Check the description for more. With the YAML ready, let's make sure Minikube is on. Minikube is also covered thoroughly in my workshop if that's of interest. Okay, the cluster is empty. Let's apply the pod and voila, it's created. Now, there's an error due to Postgres naturally not being able to find the volume, but nevertheless, the code is applied and accepted by the cluster. That is a big win. We can even query some logs with kubectl to see Nginx starting its workers in the background. Last but very much not least, Podman comes with Podman Desktop, a UI that does a lot when you first launch it. It offers onboarding with some extremely useful extensions, like being able to use Podman Compose, like Docker Compose, with existing setups out of the box, as well as kubectl for other options from within the UI. With that out of the way, here's the UI showing Podman and Docker running. We'll kill Docker for a minute to show the indication turning off. Under the Containers tab, we get all of the containers in the system, whether active or exited. Choosing a running container will present some data, live feed of logs. We can inspect the config from the UI and get a Kubernetes manifest ready for deployment. But beyond all that, there's a terminal shell attached to the container, which we can use directly to debug my container immediately. That's some good stuff right there. Here's our web app pod from earlier showing multiple containers running under the same roof. We can also see images downloaded, volumes in the system, and get this, a Kubernetes dashboard. What? This is worth having, even if you skip everything I've said so far. Let's get Docker back on so we can have our local Minikube back in operation. And with Minikube on, here's everything in a UI. The Minikube nodes, services, YAMLs, config maps, even an option to configure port forwarding. Now, while this is currently pointing at my local Minikube, I can change it to any other cluster I have configured and explore it remotely using Podman Desktop. So you've got yourself an open source alternative to Docker and you're almost ready to take on Kubernetes, but a container manager is just a start. Here's a video with extremely useful tools I incorporated into my own workflow over the past decade. I'm sure you'll be surprised. Thank you for watching and I'll see you on the next one.